Welcome to the 20th meeting of the Larkin High School Royals and the Elgin High School Maroons. This is the 20th meeting. Larkin holds an 11-8 edge in this series, and the Royals have won the last 3 years, including a 48-20 win last year. Let's go down on the field for a preview of the game. Due to last night's Upstate 8 conference action, the game between the Elgin Maroons and the Larkin Royals today doesn't really go for the Upstate 8 conference title like everyone thought it would. Last night in the Upstate 8, East Aurora beat West Aurora 19-7, DeKalb beat St. Charles 17-0, and Lake Park beat Streamwood 28-0. Now East Aurora will be representing the Upstate 8 conference in the state playoffs, so Larkin and Elgin are going to be playing for the U46 championship. Elgin High School has a record of 3-3 in the Upstate 8 conference, as does Larkin. So a win today for the Elgin Maroons would give them a winning season in the conference with a 4-3 record, something they haven't had in 4 years. The Larkin Royals have a cumulative record of 4-4, and if they should lose this game, that would give them a record of 4-5, a losing record for Coach Ray Haley, something that you won't see happening very often for Larkin. Now today, assisting me in covering this game will be Stan Donegan. He'll be giving some color commentary. Also, Terry Schabert, who is coaching the Larkin sophomore football team, will be up in the booth giving us his insights to the game. Stan, what do you look for from Elgin High School today?
Well, I think, first of all, Kenny, you have to look at the explosiveness of the running backs, Tony Gross and Preston Hinton. And quite recently, David Mabry, has been quite a surprise. Also, on the outside, you have John Covington. That's a threat every time he handles the ball. And at tight end, Rick Plagey has progressed quite well in the last couple games. He's caught a lot of passes and runs with a lot of determination.
And for the Elgin defense, who are some of the people there that we should be looking for?
I think some of the standouts in the line are Conwell Carrington, Darren Thompson, Rick Plagey, defensive backs like John Covington, and again, Tony Gross will be very important parts of that defense.
For the Larkin Royals, the running game is going to be their key to success. Right now, John Covington has, from Elgin High School, has 527 yards in receptions compared to the whole Larkin team, which only has over 400 yards in passing. However, it should be a good matchup between two quarterbacks. Ron Seatman, a junior, a good passer, has accumulated over 700 yards in passing, whereas Kirk Abbott, a senior, runs the ball well, has run for over 200 yards. Now, Abbott's favorite receivers are John Haas, who's an excellent player, also is the mainstay of the Larkin defense. Tom Vodder at linebacker is also someone to watch on defense, and a linebacker, and the nose man, Mike Austin, is going to be a key. Larkin's defense is out to stop the run. They may employ some different defensive tactics to try and slow down the Elgin Maroon running game. Assisting us in today's telecast will be Brad Nelson from Elgin High School. He'll be doing the spotting, and Ken Hudgens from Elgin High School will be doing the statistics. This is an important game for coaches, the players, and the community. Earlier this week, we talked to some of them about the upcoming game. Ray, what can we expect from Larkin High School on Saturday?
Well, I think that this game, just like all the rest of them this year in the conference, will be a tough game. There's the margin of winning in all the games throughout the conference has been very close this year, and I think it'll be a hard-fought, tough game.
What about Elgin High School? I know you've watched them play and you've heard a lot about them. They're right in town. What do you think you'll see from them?
Well, they've got tremendous speed. They've got three or four kids that really have just outstanding speed, well above what you think is excellent speed. And so I think a job for us is going to be to contain some of their backs and their ends and try to keep the ball away from them as much as possible.
Kirk, what are your thoughts on this game coming up Saturday against Elgin High School?
Well, I'd really like to win it because I think that we'll look back on this for the rest of our lives and we'll want to win our crosstown rival and kind of the U46 championship between Streamwood and us and Elgin.
Now, one thing in triple option football, teams like to shut down the pitch man and the dive back, and they like to tee off on the quarterback, and Elgin High School might be doing that. What do you think?
I'll be ready. I think I'll be ready.
Well, Elgin High School does have some outstanding running backs. Tony Gross is one of them. Do you have any plans to stop Tony?
Well, yeah, we have new defense put in and set up to shut down Tony Gross especially and the rest of the Elgin offense.
What do you think of this game coming Saturday?
It's it's going to be a big game of our season, probably the biggest, and we're going to shut them out, hopefully.
Well, I look for, I think probably a typical game would be a good running game on both sides. You know, we didn't throw the ball that much against Streamwood. The running game was going pretty well, so we didn't really, go to the air that much. And we went to it five times and completed one for a 20-yard touchdown to John Covington. So, I don't know, we kind of go with, you know, what teams are giving us, and I think Ray probably do the same thing. He's, of course, you know, a wishbone team, they normally don't throw that much, so we anticipate it's going to be a strong, kind of a grinded-out type, affair.
What do you expect to see that Larkin to do?
Well, I expect him, like I say, to keep the ball on the ground and pass when they have to. I think the Elgin-Larkin game at this time, the way things are going, is kind of up in the air and up for grabs. And, I think, we could expect, some kind of trick plays. I'm sure they're probably expecting trick plays from us. And, I think it's going to be a matter of a real good guessing game. And, defense is probably going to be the key this week again. So, we're going to work hard on defense, and we got to stop their option. And they do a good job of it. And they're a power team, and we got to stop their inside running game and force them to go outside. So, I think it's going to be all in all, I think it's going to be a real good, hard-fought, close game.
This game is probably the most important game that, probably in my high school career, because we haven't beaten Larkin since I've been up here. And I know they'll be watching out for me and stuff like that, but this is a big game for me in my last game.
Now, how does it affect you? A lot of people know you're a good running back, and they key on you and really go after you. What does that do to you before a game?
It really doesn't bother me, If you break through the line, no matter if they're keying on you or not, it doesn't matter because you're going to go and they ain't going to catch you, So it really doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah, when we were sophomores, we lost 10-8, and we lost 48-20 last year. So I've never been on a team that has beaten Larkin. And it's really important that we win this game. I don't want to lose. I want to go out and we'll have a winning conference record. First time in 3 years for Elgin. So I think we're going to win.
Officials for today's game are Joe Slayton, line judge, Dave McIntyre, the umpire, Ken Trainer, referee, and Frank Muscardini, the linesman. Coin toss at center out of midfield. The Larkin Royals will be receiving and defending the north goal. Elgin High School will be kicking.
Receiving the kickoff and defending the goal to our left.
Before we come back to the opening kickoff and the Star Spangled Banner from Memorial Field, let's pause for this.
If you're shipping by air, you've missed the bus. This time, send your business and personal packages Greyhound with Elgin Bus Depot's Greyhound Package Express. Not only will your packages get there just as quick, you'll save 50% over your current delivery service, and you'll receive good old-fashioned friendly service door-to-door from the Elgin Bus Depot. This time, call the Elgin Bus Depot at 741-7202. That's 741-7202. If it's not Greyhound Package Express, more than just your packages are going out the door.
Elgin High School and Larkin High School will be performing this afternoon for you. The Elgin High School Maroons are under the direction of the... all please rise and sing with the combined Larkin and Elgin band as they play our national anthem, directed by Mr. Pat Kenning.
Now let's take a look at the starting lineups for today's game. First of all, we want to take a look at the Elgin High School defense. And then the Larkin Royal offense. The Elgin High School offense. And the Larkin High School defensive squad. Think defensive lineup for the Elgin Maroons. At nose guard, number 51, a senior, Darren Thompson. At right tackle, number 79, a sophomore, Reggie Richardson. At the left tackle, number 64, senior, Tom Parr. And at one end, number 83, a senior, Rick Plagey. At the other defensive end, number 61, senior, Scott Fredrickson. At one linebacker, number 21, senior, Tony Gross. At the other linebacker, number 30, a junior, David Mabry. Starting at Buckman, number 24, junior, Eric Beer. At Buck Corner, number 14, a senior, Kevin Baldwin. Starting at free safety, number 31, a junior, Mike Ross. And starting at free corner, number 8, senior, John Covington. The starting lineup for the offensive team for the Larkin Royals: at center, a senior, number 53, Charlie Propernick. At left guard, a senior, number 55, Mike Austin. At right guard, a senior, number 66, Greg Satani. At left tackle, a junior, number 77, Ron O'Neill. At right tackle, a senior, number 65, Ron Plate. At tight end, a senior, number 81, Scott Miller. At split end, a senior, number 36, Grant Entner. And at fullback, a senior, number 44, Pat Booby Davidson. At left halfback, a senior, number 40, Ken Harris. And at right halfback, a senior, number 31, Steve Barkley. And at quarterback, a senior, number 11, Kirk Abbott. The Larkin Royal offensive starters. And now the starting lineup for the Elgin Maroon offense: at center, number 54, a senior, Jim Elbert. And at right guard, number 70, junior, Conwell Carrington. At left guard, number 61, senior, Scott Fredrickson. At right tackle, number 75, senior, Tom Cothran. And at left tackle, number 64, senior, Tom Parr. And at tight end, number 83, senior, Rick Plagey. Split end, number 8, senior, John Covington. At swing back, number 14, senior, Kevin Baldwin. And at left half, number 30, a junior, David Mabry. Starting at right halfback, number 21, Tony Gross. And starting at quarterback, a junior, number 15, Ron Seatman. And the Elgin High School coaching staff: Dale Schabert, Gary Everett, Dave Sauerbaugh, and the head coach of the Elgin Maroons, Steve Evangelist. The starting defensive lineup for the Larkin Royals: a nose guard, senior, number 55, Mike Austin. At left tackle, a senior, number 60, Ross Perez. At left end, a senior, number 80, Bart Erickson. At right end, a senior, number 53, Charlie Propernick. At right linebacker, number 35, a senior, Tom Vodder. At left linebacker, a junior, number 29, Scott Brummel. And at safety, number 27, senior, John Haas. And at junior, number 14, Howard Power, starting at cornerback. And at free safety, number 32, a senior, Willie Kaufman. And at safety, a senior, number 21, Mike Meinhardt. And at cornerback, a senior, number 40, Ken Harris. Well, we're getting ready for the opening kickoff here between the Larkin Royals and the Elgin High School Maroons. Larkin has a 3-3 record in the Upstate 8 Conference, as does Elgin. So this will be a grudge match between the two clubs. Terry, what do you expect to see from Larkin today?
Well, I think they'll try to establish the fullback on the option. And if we can establish him inside, of course, it makes it a lot easier to run the ball outside.
There's a strong breeze blowing here out of the south, blowing the ball off the tee. Tom Cothran kicking off for Elgin High School. Left-footed kicker, also kicks the extra points for Elgin. And I'm thinking if he gets in close, he'll be able to put a field goal across. And Larkin High School has an excellent kicker also in Kirk Abbott. Here's Cothran's kick. Going deep to Barkley. He slips, and he's down around the 2-yard line. So a big break for Elgin High School.
Is this better?
As Steve Barkley slipped and his knee hit out of around the 3-yard line, so it's first and 10. Larkin in their opening series. Kirk Abbott, the quarterback, going to be calling the play for Coach Ray Haley's team. Haas is split left. Abbott comes out. Hand off inside to Steve Barkley on a lead play.
It's pretty tough to run the option down this close to your own end zone.
It certainly is. You know, I think they'll stay probably with that fullback most of the time until they get up around the 10, 15 yard line, and then they'll go with that pitch. That pitch is pretty dangerous down inside the 20.
Second and 8 for Larkin on the 5 yard line. Wishbone set. A little car coming back to Barkley picks up good yardage and a first down. I think the Elgin linebackers did read that very well. Tackle was by Mike Ross, a junior, a free corner for the Elgin defense.
Had he not cut that back, he might have gone a long way. It stayed on the outside. He cut back at the last moment there and it might have been
a
long
way. And that's stop the linebackers from falling so fast with the fullback.
Haas split left, first and 10, Larkin. A fake inside to Davidson. Hand off to Barkley. It looks like he's going to be the workhorse today. Pick up of about a yard, be second and 9. Tony Gross from the Maroons, playing at linebacker, made that tackle. Hand off inside to Davidson, another lead play. They're really trying to work the middle. Tackle was by Darren Thompson and Tom Parr. Looks like they're trying to work on the middle of that Elgin defense.
Well, everybody stacks against us the outside, and they try to pinch down inside. He's cut off the middle, so sometimes you have to establish your inside game, otherwise you're in trouble.
Harrison Haas split wide to the right. Broken bone formation. Abbott rolling. Nice pass by Haas. Reception by Haas. Takes the ball to the 38-yard line. Another first down.
They caught Elgin in the zone coverage that time, and they give him quite a bit of cushion. They're going to have to come up a little quicker on that. That quarterback had a lot of time that time.
Mike Ross made the tackle.
That's John's ninth catch already, and he's only played wide receiver the last three games. So he's the leading receiver on the team.
Wishbone, Haas split left. Hand off inside to Ruby Davidson. Brings the ball, picks up good yardage inside. Tackled by Reggie Richardson, a sophomore, and Darren Thompson. Coming into the Elgin lineup, Preston Hinton. And a defensive end for Scott Fredrickson.
If you can't get them gloves off Preston, he doesn't need those things. It's not that cold.
Wishbone, Haas split left.
Elgin defense a little confused in the secondary this time.
Abbott running the option, makes a nice cut. Tackle out there, making good pursuit. The left tackle, number 64, Tom Parr. Another first down for Larkin. Now they're in Elgin territory for the first time.
That was Larkin's version of the veer, Houston veer. It's a veer to the sixth hole and puts a lot of pressure on the defensive end.
Haas split left. Counter play coming back inside to Harris. Picks up short yardage, tackled by the nose man, Darren Thompson.
Wishbone offense puts an awful lot of pressure on a defense. Everybody has a place to go and has to be there. So any confusion in that Elgin secondary is going to cause serious problems and is a big plus for the Larkin Royals.
Second 8 for Larkin on the Elgin 45. 8 minutes to go in the first quarter. Abbott on the option. Nothing there. Tackle by Plagey. Rick Plagey, the defensive end, came in, shut that down, and make it a third and 8 yards for the Royals.
We could probably look for Haas someplace to try to get on open inside the seam of the zone.
Charlie Propernick, the center for the Royals, leads them out. Play action fake.
Ooh.
Tipped by Tony Gross. A little underthrown. That was intended for Scott Miller. So it's fourth down. Punting situation.
John Covington will be dropping deep in single safety.
Charlie Propernick kicking the ball. Matt Miller snapping for the punt. Nice high punt, turning over.
That's interference.
hit off the Larkin player. Cummington called for the fair catch. Looks like there could be a player interference call interfering with the free catch. Official signal interference call. Elgin should pick up some free yardage on this one. Big break for the Maroons because they would have had the ball on the 10-yard line.
Charlie's done an outstanding job all year punting the ball for us, and I think it's averaged 34 yards per punt, and he's just a good football player.
So it's first down. The penalty is declined by the Maroons. I think if the Maroons would have taken that penalty, there would have been another kick. So they probably wanted to take the ball and start now. So it's first and 10 with 7:30 in the first quarter. Elgin's first possession of this game.
We got
Cummington split left, Baldwin right, handoff to David Mabry inside, short yardage. Tackled by Ross Perez.
I don't know, maybe we weren't set.
And another flag on this play.
Holding call against the Elgin Maroons. Correction, that's a personal foul.
What did you call?
So two flags coming up quick in this first quarter. Going over the Larkin defense at noseman, it's Mike Austin. At left tackle, it's Ron Plate. At right tackle, Ross Perez. At the one end, Bart Erickson. The other end, Charlie Propernick. Linebackers, Tom Vodder and Scott Brummel. Hand off to David Mabry. Good pickup.
Looks like Larkin's in a 43 defense.
Hey, Larkin's in 4-3. Is that 43. A change, Terry, from
usually we're a basic 52 defense, but I see they're in a 43 now.
Making an adjustment to try and shut down to the outside beer,
right. Yes, right. So they have three linebackers, Brummel and Botter and Haas.
Pro set, coming to the split. Hand off again to Mabry.
And very close to the first down.
Tackled by linebacker Tom Botter. First down for Elgin.
The whole idea of 43 defense is that outside backer on that side has to come up and fill that outside tackle gap, and the inside backer should end up coming in and making the tackle. If he gets there late, you're in trouble.
Elgin in a definite passing formation, I say. First time they split both receivers.
There's a speed option. Pitch to Mabry. Nothing there at all. Tackle for a loss by Erickson. So it's a second and 12 for Elgin High School.
And this will probably be our first opportunity to see that Seatman to Covington combination go to work.
Well, they've combined for over seven. Covington's had 500 yards so far this year in reception. Brian Baldwin swing back in motion with a fake to the dive. Ball is tipped by Bart Erickson, so it's incomplete.
That looked that time looked like Larkin jumped back into a 52 defense that time. Put more people up front, probably expecting a pass play and try to get more rush on them.
Terry, with John Covington being such a threat, will Larkin secondary do anything different with him this game?
I don't think so. They won't double him up or anything. They'll just play their basic zone defense. And maybe occasionally they might jump to a man and throw a linebacker in there on the quarterback. But other than that, they'll just play basic.
Third down and 13 for Elgin. Ball on about the 16-yard line. There's a draw play to Tony Gross. Has some running room. He's outside. Getting a good block by John Covington. Tripped up by Haas. Tripped up by Haas. A nice play. A draw play catching the Royals off guard. Picking up a first down. Tony Gross, outstanding running back for Elgin High School.
As you mentioned, a super block by, stand-up block by John Covington.
that works real well, so then you get those defensive backs out there playing fast, and they don't see that draw very well, and they're in the open.
Twin receivers left, Kevin Baldwin inside, handoff to Gross, cutting back, picking up good yardage off the right side, tackled by Mike Austin.
Slot left.
And Scott Brummel.
I mean, slot right, quick pitch left. Pick up a five.
Second and five.
Mike Austin.
4 minutes into the, 4 minutes left in the first quarter here. The 20th meeting of the Elgin Maroons and the Larkin Royals.
That's all they ever do. They're in four right now, fellas.
Once again, Covington split wide. Pro set. Quick pitch to Mabry. Tripped up. By Scott Brummel, linebacker, a good play because it will force the Elgin into a possible passing situation on third down.
See, those outside backers are keying the onside halfback on their side, and where they go, they go. And it's just a matter of getting there. With Elgin speed, sometimes it's not that easy to get there.
Emmett Stemweddle enters the game for Larkin as a defensive tackle.
Okay, now Larkin's in her 52.
Covington in motion. Play action fake, nothing there. Seaman keeps the ball, picks up short yardage. Tackled by most of the interior of the Larkin defensive line. The Larkin's defense has been a mainstay all year, keeping the scores down, keeping them in almost every game they play.
We've only had two bad games, the St. Charles game, where they ran all over us, and then I thought last week we didn't play very well against Lake Park. And that was the turning point of the game. The offense moved the ball, but defense is on the field all the time. They couldn't stop them.
John Covington coming in to punt for Elgin. Haas and Powers. Punch block.
Recovered by.
And he's in for a touchdown. Going over.
37 yards.
Going 37 yards on a touchdown run. Mike Austin. Punt was blocked by the Larkin Royals. Mike Austin, who's done that before this year. He did that against Barrington, an 88-yard touchdown run. Punt was blocked by Scott Brummel. Coming in from the outside, John Covington does have a tendency to take his time kicking the ball. So puts Larkin up. 6-0.
Illinois has the ball.
Kirk Abbott, who's an excellent point after attempt specialist, which has been kind of a bugaboo for Ray Haley's squad this year, Terry.
Yeah,
those extra points have really hurt.
There's a little indecision most of the time when they're out there.
Flag down.
Kirk is kicking with a damaged right knee that he damaged in a skiing accident, and it's amazing the way he can kick the ball. Because he plays with the same kind of brace that McMahon for the Bears wear. So he, there are a lot of good kickers in the league this year. The fellow from Lake Park's very good, and Kirk's real good.
Half the distance to the goal, Elgin High School offside. Well, Mike Austin did run 188 yards against Barrington, so I think he likes to get his hands on the ball. Once he does, to really motivate. Larkin going for 2 points. Abbott with the pitch to Barkley. Nobody there. A flag down.
He called, I think, Booby Davis for holding there on that play. And I think all option coaches feel the rule where you can't hit below the waist coming out of the backfield. Change the option game a lot. And I think that most of the option coaches love to see the kick go back to the old where you can block below the waist.
So it's pretty difficult to block a defender moving toward the ball when you just have to hit him high.
That's right. They bounce off and they can still make the play where before you could knock him down and they'd be out of the play.
So it's a 15-yard penalty against Larkin. Barkley will be putting the ball down on about the 25-yard line. Making this a 35-yard attempt by Abbott, and it's good. What a leg for a high school kicker.
He's kicked one 45 yards this year in a field goal. So
yeah, that was against Addison in the second game of the season.
Right. It's amazing to think that, I think he had a 6-hour operation on his knee when he tore it up. To see him out there kicking that distance, it's really amazing.
Well, especially against St. Charles, too, when you kick two field goals, especially one with about 18 seconds left in the game to give the Royals a victory.
It's a lot of pressure on a high school kid to come out there with the game on the line and try to kick a 35, 40-yard field goal.
So at 3:12 of the first quarter, a blocked punt was picked up by Mike Austin. He rambled 37 yards for the score. The kick for extra point was good. Scores Larkin 7, Elgin nothing.
Now that might go down in the upstate records as probably the longest point after attempt kick on record. I mean, it's usually about a 10-yard kick, but Larkin had to kick it from the 25. Abbott kicking off, deep to receive, Covington, Mabry, and Gross for the Maroons. Covington takes the ball, bottles it, picks it back up on about the 10-yard line, breaking outside. He's got some speed. Abbott's the only one left. Covington looks like he can go all the way, but there is a flag. Covington taking the ball 90 yards.
That kid turned right into the line.
John Covington almost making it. However,
that was a beautiful block.
Looks to me as they called a clip or a hold on number 88 from Allison High School.
That always happens. It seems like 90% of the time it happens when that first, you know, you bobble it and that wave goes by and you see an awful lot of run backs like that.
I think the thing is everybody latches up a little bit on the way down there because you see them bobble on the ball. And there's the old bugaboo again with not being able to block the roll of the waist again. You have to hit a person up above. And it looked to me like the blocker saw him coming and just turned. And that's official's judgment, but it very well could have been a clean block.
I think a lot of times when the young man backs up, you know, you had him in your sights, and then you just go lower than you wanted to. When the young man backs up, you just can't get that above the waist block.
Well, being a coach, sometimes, especially with clipping and holding and that, I feel that probably I lend more to the players. They let them play, and it's more fun for the fans, too.
So instead of getting a touchdown, Elgin High School has a scored fullback for a clipping penalty, puts the ball on the 24-yard line, first and 10, hand off to Gross, keeps driving, dives, picks up about 7 yards on that play.
Larkin had the people in the hole. They just didn't wrap their arms around him and tackle him.
Tony Gross is a hard runner. He's built low to the ground, about 170 pounds in a small frame. Says he likes to run like Billy Sims.
Unfortunately, I'll have to see him in baseball season, too.
He's an outstanding athlete.
Yes.
Coming to the split right, Baldwin in the slot position. Hand off to Mabry driving, and another flag down.
On the play, the ball carrier, Dave Mabry. That must
have been with the tackle. Holding. A holding call against the Maroons.
Holding against the Maroons.
Just when Elgin seems to be getting a drive going or get a break, some of those yellow flags pulls him back.
Let's just run a beer. Let's run a beer.
Puts the ball back.
Puts the ball down on the 18-yard line.
Left. Let's go. Slot left.
So Ron Seaman, a little pressure put on him now. The Elgin High School offense, center Jim Elbert, right guard Conwell Carrington, right tackle Tom Cochran, a tight end Rick Plagey, left guard Scott Fredrickson, left tackle Tom Parr, split end John Covington, number 14 is Kevin Baldwin, the swing back, Gross and Mabry are the halfbacks. Ball is in the air. Looks like it didn't even get into Tony Gross.
Thought he had the ball. He thought the quarterback had the ball.
Picked up by Tom Botter. Another big break for Larkin. And their defense, once again, is proving to be probably their best offense today, giving Larkin the ball on the Elgin High School 21-yard line.
Elgin
Hand off to Davidson inside, picking up good yardage, dragged down from behind by Tom Parr.
That time Larkin got out of the bone and they went flanker, I think left and split right, and they just quick pop, just like a la Elgin High School.
I think it's very important for Elgin to stiffen here because down two touchdowns to a Ray Haley coach team is not a good situation to be in.
And they were straight thin. They were straight thin.
Wishbone and the had fake inside and Abbott follows from the middle.
Let's just call it a quarterback cutback. They go hoping the defense will flow with the fullback and the quarterback can cut back to the backside. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't.
Straight 50 the last three times. Yeah.
Elgin defense.
Yeah.
Trying to hold Larkin now, first and 10 on the 10-yard line. Fake to Davidson. Abbott tripped up by Tony Gross, but continues to pick up 3 or 4 yards.
I think he had a pitch that time. He just elected to carry the ball himself.
Eric Beer, the buck man from Elgin High School, is over there also. Elgin has been riddled a little bit by injuries this year. Joe Arnold, who should be out there playing Buckman and helping out on offense, has a sprained ankle. Fake inside on a cross buck play. Harris scores. 7-yard touchdown run by Ken Harris. On a crossback play, Harris limping slightly coming off the field. It gives Larkin a 13-0 lead with 20 seconds left to go in the first quarter. Kenny's been probably one of the top runners for Larkin this year.
Oh, he's got leading rusher. I think he has 504 yards, and he had a 73-yard touchdown against DeKalb. He had an outstanding game against DeKalb. But then, yeah, there's a counter play. Sent the fullback one way and brought the bat back the other way.
Barkley holds. Abbott's kick is good. Larkin ahead, 14-0.
One fumble, don't you think, though, it's hard to on that outside here for the quarterback to read that in, especially the split second indecision when you give the ball to the fullback and the halfback and pick it out and pitch it.
Just like you said, that indecision is causing that problem. You have to know, I mean, you have to take the offense. You can't let the defense play you. Larkin took over on the 21-yard line, their own 20, or Elgin's 21-yard line. That was a four-play drive. Ken Harris went over from 7 yards out. Abbott kicked the extra point. The score with 20 seconds left in the first quarter. Larkin 14, Elgin nothing.
Kirk Abbott, who's Mr. Everything for the Larkin Royals, kicking off deep. We have John Covington, Tony Gross, David Mabry for Elgin. High kick. Covington will take it on the 8-yard line. Breaks it left. Tackled by Mark Bergeron. Bring it back to the 18. Once again, we have a flag down on the field.
We're talking about the 19-18. Holding on us.
Another holding call against Elgin, and the penalties have been mounting up.
Well, they sent one man down after the kicker, and he got in his face, and then he started, looked to me like he just got caught a shoulder as Kirk tried to get away, and then Kirk threw him down. It could have been a penalty both ways, really.
So once again, Elgin High School must start with poor field position, something that Coach doesn't really want to have, especially when he's down by two touchdowns. They have the ball first and 10 on the 15-yard line.
With this, the type of offense Elgin has, though, any coach would rather have him starting at the 10 than starting at midfield. Any second, they can go 80, 90 yards.
Well, it's 3 penalties against Elgin High School for 45 yards, but it's cost them a lot more territory and 1 touchdown. That's the end of the first quarter with a score, Larkin 14, Elgin 0. We'll be back for more of the second quarter after this message. Thank you.
Gentlemen, start your burgers.
It all begins here at Corn's Freeze in Elgin. From the moment your selection hits the grill, you know that your food will be cooked to your satisfaction. Fresh condiments are always used, from just a little to a lot. Corn's Freeze is a family-owned business that's been serving Elgin for over 20 years. You can get your fast food orders filled elsewhere, but if you want it good, get it at Corn's Freeze.
First and 10 for Elgin, first play of the second quarter, ball on the 10-yard line. Hand off to Mavery, short yardage, stacked up by the inside of the Larkin Royals.
If you notice that time, he's the backside linebacker that time, and both backs go away. He's on a fly right now to the to that lead halfback's hole.
Evan Stenwettle in there, and a defensive tackle for Larkin.
This is a good defense if you have
along
the linebackers.
Long with Papernick, Erickson, and Austin, the interior of that line. Ronnie Steele for Elgin in motion. Hand back to Gross. Tony Gross picks up excellent yardage, tackled by John Haas. Linebackers for the Royals, Mike Meinhardt.
When you only have one linebacker, that's the kind of thing you have to worry about is that county, when you only have one linebacker in the middle.
That linebacking crew again, Tom Vodder, Scott Rummel, and Mike Meinhardt. Gross on the beer, nothing there. Cuts it back. Picking up good yardage, makes a nice cut. Another flag down. A late hit. Tackled out there by Charlie Propernick. A lot of penalties in the game like this. Must be a lot of excitement, a lot of tension, pressure in the last game for some seniors out there.
No, it's the last time some of them will ever play football again, probably. And you always want to make this the one that you can remember.
Good field position for Elgin now on their own 43-yard line, first and 10. 10 minutes to go in the first half. Fake to Hinton. Reverse coming back to John Covington. Tackled by Charlie Propernick. Ronnie Steele and Kevin Baldwin running plays in for Coach Steve Evangelist.
That time Larkin jumped into the 52 defense again and probably covered up one of the guards, and he didn't pull and left the halfback coming around wide open with no protection.
Larkin has had two penalties in the game so far for 30 yards. Second and 10. Handoff inside to Preston Hinton. Picks up about five. Tackled by the linebackers, Bonner and Rumble again. Third down and six for Elgin on the 48-yard line. Ronnie Steele brings the play into Ron Seatman. Plaguing the tight end on the left side, Covington split right with Steele in the slot. Quick pitch to Preston Hinton, Tom Parr out in front. Tripped up.
There again is the outside linebacker.
Tripped up again by Scott Rummel.
It's an interesting situation right here. Fourth down, midfield, and Elgin has finally established a little bit of a running game. They've gone now eight plays and trying to hold on to that ball.
Greg Satani entering the game.
Looks like they're going to go for it here.
Along with Evan Stemwettle with a fourth and short yardage. Gross and Seatman run into each other.
Lucky on that play if they did get the first down with that bumping in the backfield.
Charlie Propernick again making the tackle. time for a measurement.
I think Larkin jumped at a goal line defense that time.
Boy, that lack of execution there certainly could have hurt the Maroons. And did.
First down. Gross might have picked up that extra yard if he hadn't run into Ron Seaton.
Kind of broke the timing on the play.
Yeah, he needed all the momentum, and that robbed him of a little.
So it's Larkin's ball with eight and a half minutes left in the first half.
I wouldn't be surprised to see Larkin go up over the top of the windstill.
Broken bone.
Broken bone. Hair split. Abbott fakes. Pitch to Barkley. Eric Beer, the Buckman for the Elgin Maroons, comes up and makes the tackle. Now, Terry, people talk about wishbones and broken bones. What's the difference?
Well, a basic wishbone is full house backfield. When they say broken bone, they're taking one of the halfbacks out of the backfield and either putting him in a slot or a flanker position.
Holding call.
I see here again we've got a holding call, and probably stems from not being able to block below the waist. And when that Buckman that you, as you referred to, turned inside to try to turn the play inside, the back caught him because he had to block him straight up.
Broken bone also lends itself a little better to passing, doesn't
right,
it?
Right, it does.
Grant Entmeyer split left. Larkin out of the eye. Abbott dropping back, screen pass to Barkley. Preston Hinton and Rick Plagey tripping him up. First time I've seen Larkin in the eye this game.
Well, they feel that Steve Barkley could play eye, but you know, Ray likes to stay with the bone, and that's just a change up, something a little bit different to throw in there, maybe break one big play or whatever.
Would you think it's more of a passing formation than a run?
Oh, it's definitely a lot more of a passing because you have at least three wide outs that you have to cover.
Haas split wide right. Barkley split left. Davidson and Harris in the backfield. A quick out to Haas. Picks up six. Tackled by Preston Hinton. David Mabry.
That's what you have to do. You have to. You don't can't go for it all. You've got to take a little at a time here, 6 or 7 yards, and try to get some of it back.
I think Larkin's game plan is right on schedule because they've dominated with time of possession, and I think that's a wise move. Keep the ball, keep it out of the hands of Elgin, because they're
right.
Awful explosive.
That was their game plan.
Third and 17 for Larkin on the 41. Play action fake. Pass attempted and out of bounds for Grant Entner. Broken up by Mike Ross.
He ran out of room there. And so that pass would have been better coming to the wide side of the field there.
Well, there were two people open on that play, Terry.
Right.
I think a well-thrown ball, or even he just ran out of room. Because people were wide open. It was an excellent fake. So it's fourth. So it'll be fourth down here.
I think the thing about the wishbone, not only you still have to play the run, because the bone, you can bust it for, you know, 35, 40 yards in fullback. So you have to still play the fake.
Miller snaps to Propernik, taking his time. Another fine, deep kick. Covers and takes it out of 13. Bottles it. Loses it. Recovered on the 1 yard line by Eric Beer. Fortunately, Eric was here to cover up. John Covington seemed to have a little trouble today holding on to the football and kickoffs and punts.
Well, the first one, I don't know what happened, but down that one, I think looking back into the sun, I'm being down in the field during the sophomore game, our receivers were having a rough time looking back into the sun.
Also, the wind's blowing right in his face, and he might have put a little knuckle on that ball, too.
So for the third time in a row, Elgin will be having the ball inside of the 20-yard line. It'll be first and 10 on the 1 yard line. Baldwin split left, Plagey tight right. Gross set, reverse handoff to Gross. Not too much of a pickup on that. Ross Perez and Mike Austin teaming up.
I wouldn't be surprised if Elgin came out and threw the ball. Try to take one long toss right here.
Well, there's 6 minutes left in the first half. Larkin is ahead, 14-0.
It's a pretty safe play if you get the right blocking up front to throw the ball down and intercept it with like a punt.
Hand off to Hinton on the left side. Picks up the ball at three. Tackled by Bart Erickson. Elgin has a little breathing room now. Third down. Third and four. Ball resting on the 8-yard line. Covington brings the play in for Elgin. Stephen DeGross, Tony Gross cutting back, picking up some yardage,
nice.
And it looks like one step. One person kept him from going all the way on that.
Backside middle linebacker overran the play that time. He's got to trail the play a little bit. Otherwise, Gross will cut it back and score on him if he don't slow down his pursuit.
He's pretty consistent with that play. He gets 3 yards past that line of scrimmage, and he takes a sharp left. He likes that cutback play.
He's an excellent beer running back. And so it's first and 10, the ball on the 17-yard line for Elgin. Baldwin in the slot. To Hinton, running over the left side of the Elgin line. Not a big pickup on the play. Tom Parr, the left tackle, probably the best lineman for the Elgin Maroons.
Those backs in the backfield, when you have Hinton and Tony Groves back there, they complement each other well. You got the little scooter in that. The Hinton is a big back. Once you get him on track, he can run over people.
Preston hasn't been playing for the last couple of games. He's had an injured ankle, and so David Mabry has filled in very well for him. So far, Tony Gross unofficially with 51 yards on 10 carries. Gross takes the ball again.
Tony Gross on the carry.
Picking up good, close to the first down yardage. Making third and short for Elgin, tackled by Charlie Propernick.
Actually, Elgin has moved the ball against Larkin on first and second down. What's hurt them is a lot of times they've had the penalty that's hurt them and taking them back and put them in a situation where they have to either throw the ball or think big play.
I think you're right. That's been the nemesis all year long with this Maroon team. They get going and then fumble the ball or just lack of execution sometimes.
Yeah. They put tremendous pressure on the defense.
Hinton and Gross in the backfield, reverse pivot.
There was nothing there, but first down.
Yeah.
Tony very seldom loses yardage. He's one of those backs that seems to be able to get hit, slide, and fall forward. You know, Terry's kind of nice having up here in the booth talking to you. I remember 2 years ago when you and I were on opposite ends of the field.
Right.
And it was Elgin and Larkin.
You were the smart one. You got out of coaching football. See all these gray hairs I stayed in.
Well, that was a great game. It was 10-8.
Excellent game.
First and 10 for Elgin. Hand off to Hinton. Spinning. Picking up some fine yardage. Preston Hinton. Moving well. Tackled by John Haas. Picked up about six. Terry, congratulations on the FKA conference.
Thank you very much.
For your sophomore club this year.
All right. They worked real hard. We got really drubbed the first game against the excellent Barrington team 20-0, but then we came back and only allowed 37 points for the rest of the year. So
that's tremendous.
Good defense.
Second and four on the 35. Play action fake. The plaguey interception by John Hunt. Nice cut. Still on his feet. Tackled by Tim Elbert. Plaguey was there. That's one of the plays Elgin, play action pass that Elgin likes to use all year.
That's
looking for that tight end. And Plaguey, good size.
That's the old saying, right? Three things can happen when you pass the ball and two of them are bad.
It's not like Woody Hayes
now. That's like a beer pass. That tight end is open on that. The wide out was there also. You should have had that ball.
So Larkin takes over on another Elgin miscue. Ball on the 37-yard line of Elgin. Hand off to Barkley. Tackled by Reggie Richardson, a sophomore, picking up some valuable varsity experience, and with his size, he could be something reckless.
I'm glad he was on a varsity today, not down against us.
He is a big young man.
Clock running with 1:42 left in the first half. Larkin ahead, 14-0, trying to pick up a few more points. Adam throwing deep, just tipped away by John Covington. Scott Miller was wide open as Abbott rolled right and looked down the left side of the field.
And if Sepler coming his excellent speed, that would have been another six.
That should have been thrown a little bit earlier. If you don't throw that right away when he's got a two or three step lead, that free safety usually comes over and picks that one up. But Covington got back there and made a nice play.
I thought that was rather surprising play for Larkin. I thought that they'd sit on it the last minute and a half.
Ball on the 34-yard line. Split receivers, Haas and Harris. Abbott throwing off the roll. Overthrows Haas.
Abbott pass.
Oh, he was there.
Defended by Eric Beer.
Real sound.
Clock is stopped with 1:29 here left in the first half. Ball on Elgin's 34. Harris, kind of a nasty split up on the right side. Haas wide to the sideline. Abbott rolling right. Good protection.
Abbott pass.
Incomplete. Almost intercepted by Eric Beer. The drop, and not a bad thing, really. The drop, Harrison probably picked up maybe 5 or 6 yards on that, rather than if they would have had the interception.
No, it's a smart play by Larkin, as far as going for it, because of the wind behind them. They probably would have had the ball back out on the 20, and they only gained about 15 yards on the play, so.
Kerry, you know, you've seen this, and this is something new to me, and I really like it when the coaches are able to go out on the field like Steve Evans is there talking to his team.
Well, you know, prep football, all about it is to coach the kids and teach them. And I think being able to go out there and diagram something or even take a walkie-talkie out there and somebody from the press box up, because that's what it's all about. If you're making a mistake, you should be able to go out there and explain to them. I really like that a lot.
I think also when you're inside the 10-yard line on defense, sometimes spacing is so crucial, and I think you can put the kids right in place and say, go with it, you know?
Right.
And you don't have those young men out of play.
Right.
First and 10, Elgin, ball on their own 35-yard line, 1:24 in the first half. Seatman running the speed option.
I think that's Larkin, personal foul.
It's a spear.
Yeah, it looked like a late hit.
I don't think it was so much late as that he used his head helmet when he went in there.
Tackle on that play by Emmett Stemwedel. Mike Austin leads the game for Larkin.
That's an excellent rule, I think, spearing. I think they'd use it more. The officials should call it more, especially when a ball carrier is hung up. I think they should call it more.
We should see an aerial circus here this last minute now.
It's kind of hard to throw against this room.
First and 10 on the 50. Handoff inside to Hinton. And once again, Elgin seems to have a little trouble getting their timing down. Tackled by Bonner and Brummel. Second and 8. Handoff to Gross. Nothing there. Tackled by Charlie Farfernick.
Well, that time they switched up, and Larkin went, and the defensive end took the ball carry instead of quarterback, and kind of threw the read off of the quarterback.
Third and 9, 44 seconds in the first half. Seaman pumps, throwing deep for Covington. Ball tipped, intercepted. He's at the 40, tripped up the 48-yard line by Scott Fredrickson. And that was kind of a wounded duck pass out there, thrown into the wind.
That's what I just mentioned before, but I think Howard Powers made a nice play. He went back with Covington and got in position and tipped the ball up. And Hoff was back there also playing defense, playing free safety, and excellent play.
Yeah, I also think that when you throw into the wind like that, you can't hang it up. You have to throw it on a line.
That's right.
That's what happened.
Slants or something, quick posts are better against the wind and then trying to air it out.
John Hoffman's second interception gives Larkin the ball with 31 seconds in the first half. And Larkin going with the pass. Abbott to Scott Miller. Covington making the tackle. Crossing over midfield, putting the ball into Elgin territory. The play took 6 seconds to go. 25 seconds left in the first half.
Right, that's type of bootleg pass. And the wide receiver clears out that zone and the tight end comes up underneath.
Timeout, Abbott. Timeout, Larkin. Kirk Abbott comes over to talk to Ray Haley.
This is the first time I saw Larkin. I've seen Larkin play this year, Terry. And is Coach Haley throwing the ball more than he used to?
Well, I think this year we have thrown more. I can't remember how many passes. I think Kirk's thrown 72 passes this year. So in 8 games, that averages out maybe 8 or 9 passes a game. But I think with Larkin is that they try to pick their time when they want it. If they can establish their running game, all of a sudden somebody falls asleep and then they hit that big pass. And I really don't think he's passing more, but defenses are dictating it. They're bringing, 8, 9 people up in the line of scrimmage, and you got to get them off the line of scrimmage.
Right.
With 21 seconds left to go in the first half, Larkin on top, 14-0. Grant Entner, flanked right, play action pass, pressure by Richardson.
That was a nice pass. A lot of pressure on Kirk that time, and he put it right there.
He snapped it right out of his arm. You're right.
Nice pass.
Intended for Grant Entner. John Haas bringing the play in from Ray Haley.
I wouldn't be surprised if they could pick up 5 or 6 yards if they try a field goal from this distance with the wind behind Kirk's back.
Ball sitting on the Elgin 43-yard line, 17 seconds left to go. A lot of pressure. Elgin sitting in a prevent defense with Covington, Baldwin, Beer, and Ross. Deep intercepted by David Mabry. So we're exchanging interceptions here. Is he going to hold on to the ball to the half?
And he was able to get out of bounds at the 45 to stop the clock. And
let's see how far Elgin can go with this one with 10 seconds left to go.
I don't think he saw him that time in the zone. I think the linebacker dropped off and was sitting right there, and he must not have saw him because he threw it right at him.
Now here we have a timeout for Elgin.
Yeah.
Let's take a break here and come back before we get into the halftime activities.
Thought Soto's TV is Elgin's sales and service leader for just televisions, you've got a lot more coming. Not only will you find the complete line of both RCA and Quasar TVs, but also the outstanding lines of Litton and Quasar microwave ovens, K40 products, the entire world of Atari, and Intellivision games and cartridges. Soto's TV is the only authorized Atari service center for the entire Northern Fox Valley. Soto's TV, 1016 North Liberty, Elgin, your sales and service leader for all regions.
Go.
First and 10, Elgin ball on the 45-yard line. Hand off to Hinton.
Preston Hinton on the carry. Moves across. That's
stacked
midfield.
Up there. Beautiful tackle by Tom Botter. Clock is running, and Elgin can't get a timeout. So we end the first half with the score. Elgin Larkin 14. Elgin High School 0.
Quarter, the score was Larkin 14, Elgin nothing. That's the way it stands now as we begin the second half.
Thank you, Stan. Elgin will be receiving the second half. Larkin will be kicking. Kirk Abbott will be kicking off. Deep to receive for Elgin, John Covington, David Mabry, Tony Gross. Eric Beer is the short man in the center. Squib kick, hits on the 12, Covington can't handle it, bounces out of his hands, he recovers on the 3. Picking it up, there's only one person, it's Abbott again.
A good cut by Covington. Covington taking it all away. Nobody's going to catch him now. That is a 97-yard kickoff return for a touchdown. Elgin gets on the board. John Covington looks scary back here, but when he gets the ball, he's dangerous. That would have been his second touchdown. He had one call back earlier today. So Elgin strikes quickly. An amazing kickoff return. Once again, the Larkin kickoff team looked like they slowed down a little bit and the ball was bobbled, leaving Covington the opening that he needed. Tom Cochran will be in now to try the point after. Larkin having a holder is Kevin Baldwin. Kick is off the side of the foot and good. 14-7. It's a new ball game all of a sudden.
That one sure looked like it was a little bit to the left.
I had trouble seeing that one too. I don't know.
Well, that, it looked like you didn't have a fish underneath the crossbar that time.
Well, we do still have a strong wind blowing from the south. And it looks as if the players and the officials are getting a little cold, probably didn't want to get over there and
I think that's
extend
rain.
Themselves a little bit.
Asking the official down there right now, he's asking him how come there wasn't somebody under the crossbar.
And we've seen all year long Elgin and Larkin both being involved in close games where either an extra point could decide it. That's something that can't be neglected.
There's a lot of 21-24s this year. A lot of them in the top state eight.
Kicking off for the Maroons, Tom Cochran.
Tom Cochran kicking off for Elgin.
He's for the Royals.
Deep for Larkin. Howard Powers and Barkley. Taking my powers on the 25. Shakes one tackler. Cochran grabs him and wrestles him down on about the 37-yard line.
So many times you tell your football players to put that thing away and keep it tucked in there, and they get out there and dance around, and all of a sudden their arms out there like a penguin and the ball's down on the ground.
Charlie Propernick, center, hustles out the line of scrimmage. Harris is split wide, and so is Haas. It's a pro set. Hand off to Davidson, pulled down by Darren L.B. Thompson.
That time that Larkin got out of the bone and went to a straight gear set, slipped back.
Larkin has been running the wishbone for a number of years, been very successful at it. Elgin has recently gone to the Houston gear offense in the last couple of years to take advantage of that speed. Second and seven, ball on the 40-yard line. 10:48 remaining in the third quarter. Abbott with the play action, looking for Hot. Off the fingertips, broken up by Kevin Baldwin, only Elgin player there.
He turned that defensive back around, and I guess the sun got in both of their eyes, but he certainly ran a nice route, and the defensive back was completely turned around on that play.
Very nice effort on Hockey's part, just a little bit off, looking back again into the sun, but the ball is right there. That was a nicely thrown ball.
Kirk Abbott does have a strong arm, throws the ball well. Grant in there, split wide. Harris in the slot, broken bone, roll out. Looks like a definite run. Tom Parr misses Abbott. Picking up 3 or 4 yards.
Mabry on the stop.
The tackler, Mabry.
Fourth and three.
All at the margin, 4-5.
So Elgin may have a chance to get the ball in a little bit better field position, and going back to receive the punt is John Covington. Converted quarterback, now a split end, and probably the top split receiver in the Upstate 8.
And possibly pound for pound the toughest kid on this Elgin football team.
Well, Propernick's kick rolls out of bounds on the 7-yard line, so again, Elgin
starting from inside the 10-yard line, a long way to go for a touchdown. 14-7. Larkin still on top. Here in the third quarter.
So far, I've been very impressed with Abbott's throwing, Terry. He throws a real nice ball.
But for an option quarterback, he does throw a pretty good ball.
Seatman over the center. Counter play to Gross. A very effective play. Tackled inside by Ron Plate. Scott Brummel. 5-yard pickup, second and five for Elgin.
I see Emmett Sembolano came in, so they're probably going to go to their 50 defense now.
Tony Gross says that he patterns himself after running back Billy Sims. Second and five for Elgin. Larkin in the 50 defense, five-man line. Gross struggling.
Tony Gross on the
tackled by Brummel and Austin.
It looks like
Greg Sattani. Greg Sattani coming in. When he's in there, it could be a six-man goal line defense. Short yardage. Third and a long one for Elgin. Counter play Gross stacked up by Brummel.
Scott Brummel, market tackler.
Important play for the Maroons. Officially take time to measure. This week we talked to Tony Gross and asked him who he patterned his running style after.
Well, I like Billy Sims a lot, you know. There's a lot of people say me and him running, like, you know, he stays low to the ground the same as I do. Well, I do the same as him, you know, I watch him, stuff like that.
Now, what are you planning on doing? Is football going to be something you want to continue when you finish high school?
Yeah, I want to go to college and probably go to a small college and try to play baseball and football. But my main concern is football, though.
In a situation like this, even though Elgin is down, I remember last year they had the ball on the 15-yard line and were behind 21-7 and decided to go for the first down in a situation like this. It's short by 6 inches.
I don't think they'll go right here, Kenny. They'll probably punt it away here.
So Steve Evangelist having to make a big decision here, and it's once again he's playing the gambler role by Kenny Rogers. There goes Seatman on a sneak.
Quarterback sneak.
The big play.
Looks like he got it.
Diving over Elbert and his left guard, Scott Fredrickson, and Tom Parr, the mainstay of the Elgin line. Picks up the first out in the big gamble stand. Proved you wrong. He's really going for it. He wants this one bad.
I still would have turned that ball.
Coach. You know, Coach Evangel, Steve Evangel, his Elgin football team, which has been a coach, haven't beaten Elgin. But they did beat Streamwood for the first time that Elgin's ever beaten Streamwood. First and 10. Head off to Hinton. Nice cutback.
Then again, right there, you had the linebacker overrunning the play, the backside linebacker, and he just cuts back, and there's a lot of room there.
You're right there.
Willie Kaufman made a game-saving tackle.
Elgin right there. Backs certainly do like to cut back. That's characteristic.
I said, make your cub know that.
There's an injured player on the field. We'll be back for more action from the Elgin Larkin football game after this.
Gentlemen, start your burgers.
It all begins here at Corn's Freeze in Elgin. From the moment your selection hits the grill, you know that your food will be cooked to your satisfaction. Fresh condiments are always used, from just a little to a lot. Corn's Freeze is a family-owned business that's been serving Elgin for over 20 years. You can get your fast food orders filled elsewhere, but if you want it good, get it at Corn's Freeze.
Who's the other player down there, Craig?
I think it's Tom Vodder. He was injured earlier in the year. In fact, this is probably his only fourth or fifth game playing this year, and I hope it's not the same knee he hurt. He hurt it, I think, about a week before the first ball game. And he's an excellent linebacker. He probably could have made all conference this year if he wouldn't have been injured.
Yeah, we talked a little bit about the sophomore, see what he can much time to elaborate on that. What was the score of your game today?
I think it was 28-6. And we needed it because we were started today a half a game behind East Aurora and West Aurora. They had two losses, and we won, so we won the conference by half a game.
Looks like Vodder, they're holding the left knee, possibly injury. Hitting in motion.
And outside.
Tony Gross trying to get outside.
Okay, here's Tony Gross.
Picking up the first down, tackled by Charlie Kaepernick.
Kaepernick on the top. Close to a first down. So, one to right.
Hope Thompson can get back in that game and hate to see him injured, especially in the last game.
I can't remember which leg is injured. I can't remember if it was his right one or his left one.
They're working on the left leg right now. There's a doctor on the bench, and Tom seems to be in quite a bit of pain. Ed Leshen brings the play in for Elgin. Slid back, Covington wide right, hand off inside to Hinton, tackled by the interior of the Larkin defense. And so far, except for a few plays, a few runs by Tony Grove, Elgin's passing attack has been kind of nullified.
I don't know if it's so much nullified as maybe they're trying to lull him to sleep.
Well, they haven't been able to pick up too much up the middle. Hinton had a couple nice runs. But I think Larkin's defense is showing just how tough it is.
Well, I think they really basically, I feel like they have ran the ball fairly decent. And I think they haven't had to go to the pass. But just like you say, they've been making mistakes and close it down. You have to go first and 15.
Two tight ends. Deepman running the option. Short pickup. Tackled again by Kaepernick. Leaves a third down. And a long four for Elgin. 6 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Larkin ahead 14-7. Ed Leshen split left with Covington in the slot, playing tight end on the right side. Hand off on the beard of Gross. Tripped up by Scott Brummel.
Now see, there's a backside linebacker coming over, and that time he got there a little bit slower, and he was there to get the cutback. He didn't overrun the play.
Another big decision for Coach Steve Evangelist. It's fourth down and 1 yard to go. Ball on Elgin's 37. Elgin takes the timeout. You know, Terry, another thing that people should know about is the Elgin High School freshman squad was the upstate conference champion. So we had a great year in football in U46. The freshman champions were from Elgin High School, the sophomore champions from Larkin High School, except for a couple of games. It could have gone either way. We could have had the upstate varsity game being played the title game.
Speaking of freshmen, our freshman B team was undefeated this year, and our sophomore B team was, I think, 7-1.
So the sophomore coach, how much difference is it going to mean having a freshman up there on this level?
It's fantastic. It's like some young child walking into a candy store, because you spend so much time in preseason, like in double sessions, just showing them the offense and just going over it. This year, next year when we start out,
You'll know what we're talking, the terminology. You know what's going on in the formation, so you can start in and you can teach execution a little bit more.
I think we get more time. We've caught up with the East and West Auroras now, too, because they have an extra year to deal with right. People, and now we're on the final even power.
Coach Evangel is taking the gamble again, fourth and one. Larkin in the tight defense, hand off the hit, and he breaks the corner. Trip up. Otherwise, it could have been six. Preston Hinton, track runner with excellent speed, tripped up by John Hodge. If he could have squirmed through that one, it was easy six.
We have a 6-5 defense that time, and if your middle linebacker doesn't get over there and make the play, you're in trouble because they popped that line and there's nothing there.
Ball resting just over the 45-yard line stripe in Elgin territory. Hand off to Hinton, working the right side of Larson's defense. Picked up 5. Preston has been doing an excellent job this game. Once he came back in, David Mabry hasn't seen too much action.
That's correct, yeah. And this drive has already gone 12 plays and consumed approximately 5 minutes off the clock.
I know if Larkin has gone to a 52 defense with Vodder out of there, evidently they feel like they don't have three linebackers. I don't know what's up.
Flag down, Preston Hinton picked up 3, but not another penalty. But so far, the first half has been relatively free of penalties. Hinton tackled by Harris.
I think now we'll probably see the first pass of this series.
I see Charlie Frappinick jumping around out there.
Can't lose him, he's an excellent player.
And it looks like it's his right leg, too.
And center.
Right, he's their center.
Elgin and Larkin both have 4 people that are going both ways in this game. So he sends the ball back to Elgin 34 in second down.
I think I'd have to go back to that big draw play that Tony Grote had. I think that maybe that would be a call they might go back to here.
Larkin's back defense has been effective, picking off 2 or 6.
Well, they put some pressure on the quarterback, and even if you don't get to him, if you hurry the throw.
Covington in motion with the receiver.
Crossing pass.
Pass to Covington. Fine defensive play by Sam Harris, the quarterback. Limiting Covington to a short gain on the play.
That's hard to get hit by him. He's 6'3", 195 pounds. When he hits you, it's got to hurt.
Elgin still faced with long yardage. Third down and 20 for a first down.
Again, probably right on the sidelines. They're yelling out, watch draw. There it is.
There's the draw to go. Getting outside, there's a block by Hinton. Knocked out of bounds by Howard Power. Fourth down and 15 for Elgin. Tony Gross is a hard-running man to keep contained.
He's got such a low center of gravity. He's built so low to the ground. He has big thighs and big legs and a target. Unless you really get a good shot at him and wrap your arms around you, you're going to break him with tackles. You have to gang tackle Tony Gross.
Covington to punt. Powers and Haas back. Ball bouncing on the 40-yard line. Haas picks it up. Fine open field tackle by Scott Fredrickson.
Nice run, only a 5-yard run, but a real nice run.
So Larkin takes over now in the third quarter on the 40-yard line. Wishbone. Counter play, hand back to Barkley. Picked up 4 yards. Tackled by Don Strake, who's in their linebacker. Second and 5. Second and 6.
Austin, Parker loses the ball and recovers it. Preston Hinton right there. Elgin really forced that big deep.
Well, the quarterback went too deep that time. He's got to come down the line and challenge the end. He went too deep in the backfield, and that sucks everybody to defensive end, so he can play the option and the pitch and the quarterback at the same time. He's got to come down the line and challenge the end.
So it's third and 11. Wishbone, play action fake, pressure, Preston Hinton drops Abbott on the 29-yard line. So Elgin's defense rising to the occasion, forcing Larkin back, losing 10 yards on that position.
I think that was supposed to be a bootleg pass, and guard had to get out there and cut that end off, take his outside leg away so he can't pursue, and he didn't get there.
Kropernik to punt. No pressure, and he booms one. Ball hits on the 25. And drops dead on the roll dead on the 17. Brett in there, downing the ball. Everybody gets excited at these games. First to 10 for Elgin on the 17-yard line. I think Elgin can get the ball past the 20 when it's cut off.
Yeah. They're happy at it. It must be at least 3-1 in their favor. They move the football, and they move a 3-4 series, and all of a sudden they make a mistake.
40 seconds left in the third quarter. Hitting and gross, the running back.
There we go.
Counter to gross. Backed up by Kropernik and Perez.
You have to give a little credit to that offensive line of the Elgin Maroons in the middle of Elbert, Scott Fredrickson, and Conwell Carrington. They're coming off that ball pretty well right now.
Tom Cochran, the left tackle. Tom Powell, the left guard.
I think that Botter getting hurt has dictated something. They're shooting the 350 pretty much, and it's a little easier to run that way.
Mike Austin, the nose man from Larkin, battling it out with Tim Elbert. Preston Hinton picked up a first down in the last play of the third quarter. So we end the third quarter here at Memorial Field in the 20th Elgin-Larkin football game. The score, Larkin 14, Elgin 7. We'll be back for the fourth quarter after this.
Soto's TV is Elgin's sales and service leader for just televisions. You've got a lot more coming. Not only will you find the complete line of both RCA and Quasar TVs, but also the outstanding lines of Litton and Quasar microwave ovens, K40 products, the entire world of Atari, and Intellivision games and cartridges. Soto's TV is the only authorized Atari service center for the entire Northern Fox Valley. Soto's TV, 1016 North Liberty, Elgin, your sales and service leader for all regions.
Comes out first and 10, ball on the 28-yard line. Preston Hinton driving hard off the left side.
That time Larkin got out of his straight 52 defense and brought the tackles down over the guards and put the linebackers outside. And it's just a get a little bit more mobile person out there for that three dive play or off tackle play.
Greg Centenni on the top of the Royals.
Second and 8 for the Maroons. Larkin in the 5-man line. Quick pitch to Preston Hinton. Trip. Tom Parr pulling out on the left side. Tripped up by Bart Erickson.
Here's again that block again where the tackle comes out. If the tackle comes out and cut the guy down, it's so much easier to block. And it's more obvious when you're out there trying to pull and trying to block a corner straight up. You're bound to get your arm wrapped around him here or there. again, I think really it's slowed down to the play in football, not being able to come out and cut the defensive back down.
Could be why a lot of teams are going to pass in the pass now too, Terry, because it's,
right.
It's difficult to build a good running game.
Or going more to an eye where a runner can pick his hole, but an option, you've got to make a key out there on the corner, and if you don't do that, you're in trouble. And same thing with the view.
Second and 23. Keeping on the speed option. Preston Hinton falls on the ball at the 10-yard line. Keeping pushing his thigh. Looks a little injured. Elgin does not have the depth that a lot of teams do. Their squad has been trimmed to 33 players, starting out at 57 at the beginning of the year.
Looked like Cleveland had a lot of open running room, and also the pitch option, the pitch ratio was not very good there, hitting the back a little too far. I think Cleveland thought he was going to be up there late.
Well, Cleveland questioned his side.
When the quarterback turns upfield, they've got to turn up with him and keep that pitch relationship. And looked to me like Preston was still going to the sidelines, and he started turning upfield, and once he pitched the ball, that made a difference.
Yeah, that's a concentration thing.
Right.
I even like to see it sometimes, you know, 5 yards past the line of scrimmage, keep that ratio going. You see those good college teams doing that, pitching it, you know, beyond the line of scrimmage. I think that's
a... Well, 2-on-1 is good basketball and good football, too.
That's right. That's the whole concept, is to kind of turn a fielder and get that 2-on-1 ratio and make that corner or whoever's got kids come up and tackle you.
We have an update from down on the field. Tom Vodder's ankle is injured. A new quarterback, Kevin Baldwin, in for the Maroons on a third down. Handoff on reverse to Covington. Fine tackle. Saves big yardage. Covington still picks up good yardage. Tackled by Willie Kaufman.
I'm sure the Larkin coaches are probably yelling reverse, but that was good execution on that play. They went out and kicked out the outside man, and Covington made a nice run, turning back inside.
Difficult play to run also with a new quarterback coming in with the timing.
Right, it is.
And fourth down now, Covington will have to punt it. Calls and Haas deep to Larkin.
Here comes.
Tells you a little disorganized. End over end kick, taken on the 40 by Haas. Mabry and Gross right there.
There's another good example. Howard Pollard is trying to come up and block for Vodder that time, hit the man and give him a good shot, but he bounced right off and got in on the tackle. Again, we see where they could throw at the legs. We probably would have maybe a more of a return than we did.
Also, I thought that John Covington lined up about 10 yards behind his line, and I usually like about 12 yards, you know, knowing that he had one block already.
I think that we've noticed that in the scouting report that he is a 10 yards back.
Awful close.
Larkin takes over. Wishbone Haas split right. Hand off to Booby Davidson. Tackled by the interior of the Elgin line. LB on the bottom. Tom Pond. Ken Huggins, our stat man, informs me that was Kevin Baldwin's first time in the game at quarterback all season. Thanks for the information, Ken. Larkin ball, second and 7. Davidson on a slant, off tackle. Preston hidden from the defensive end spot, digging down.
I think Larkin's trying to get back, basically, to try to get back to what they do the best, and that's run the football from tackle to tackle. And start eating up some more of that clock.
Well, speaking of the clock, Terry, there is 8 minutes left in this game. Third down and 4. Hand to Davidson. Good tackle. Good tackle there by Baldwin. Causes the fumble. Recovery by Straight from Elgin.
I feel sorry for Booby because he's been a steady ball carrier for the team for 2 years now, and last week he fumbled the ball and Lake Park kicked it in for a touchdown, and I hope it doesn't happen this time, but you've got to have two hands on the ball when people come up to tackle you.
Well, that was a heck of a hit by Kevin Baldwin. He probably wants to get that ball back now that he's got a chance to play quarterback. Baldwin coming out as quarterback,
and Larkin split left. Covington in the slot. Gross and Mabry. David Mabry in the game. Fake to Mabry. Hand off to Covington on the reverse. Nice block by Scott Frederick on the defensive end.
They've gone with Covington in the slot the last couple of plays, and now he's a running man and a pass receiving threat.
Tackle out there by Willie Kaufman and Howard Pollard.
I wouldn't be surprised if they put the ball up in the air now pretty soon because they've got the wind and a second down in 4 or 5 yards. That's not too bad a time to throw the football.
Preston Hinton in the lineup. Picks up 4 yards, close to a first down. Hand off by Kevin Baldwin. Tackled by Ross Perez. Third and short, crucial possession here for Elgin with 7 minutes left to go in the game, down 14-7. David Mabry brings the play in for Elgin. Preston Hinton leads. In Larkin territory on the 46-yard line. Larkin staying with the five-man line in their defense. Tight formation for Elgin. Throws trips. With excellent balance, his knee hit, so it is short of the first down. Tony Gross knee hit, and he still drove ahead, but the ball was marked short of the first down.
Yeah, you're right, his knee went down, and that's unfortunate, because he had pretty good momentum going in the line at that.
Another big fourth down play for Elgin.
No, I bet you they give it to number 5 on that one.
Number 21 gets the guy. That's what I'm talking about. Tony Gross.
Big call here. Baldwin hands off and carries right. Ball fumble. Larkin seems recovered. No. Officials rule play was over. First down, Elgin. Scary play there.
As soon as I'm getting chewed up on that play, I figured you were probably right.
I thought you might want to swing too high. he's a big back, and they probably figured that he can even leap over for the first down.
First and 10 on the 45-yard line of Larkin. Elgin driving with the clock rolling at 5:39. Hand off to Tony Gross, outside, tripped up by Charlie Kopernick before he could pick up, and he had running room out there. He's the person you have to watch from the Elgin back. He could break one at any time.
Larkin did extremely well that time to contain him, because once he gets outside, he is a real shooter.
Second and 9.
Maybe Tommy Vodder's back in the ball game again.
Hand off to Gross, runs into the Cochran, tackled by the interior of the Larkin defense. Ross Perez, Mike Austin, Ron Pike.
These are getting really cold out there. There's really some hitting going on because two plays in a row now, it seems like the ball's been loose on the field there.
Mike Austin looked a little shook up there in that last one. Greg Titani's coming in the game for Larkin. As a down lineman, it's third and 5 on the 41-yard line. Kevin Baldwin yet to pass in this game. Here's the reverse. Good cut by Covington. Dive. Could have been there. Bart Erickson, the player forcing that. I could almost expect that play because I don't think there's not much passes yet. Kevin Baldwin's pass, he hasn't thrown one yet.
What amazes me is that Elgin can consistently establish that ground game. I didn't think that, they do break the long ones periodically, but they're running on Larkin pretty well right now.
Yes, they are. They're running real well.
First and 10, Elgin on Larkin's 32. Mabry inside, not much yardage there. John Haas comes up.
Mabry's out there. He has two on the play, second and 8.
3:25 remaining in the game. The clock is running. Elgin in Larkin territory, moving the ball. Kevin Baldwin replacing Ron Seatman, who went out with an injury. Little mix-up there. Covington fumbled. And there was a timing factor on that one. You can see that play didn't have it from the time he took the snap. Tough to lose a down here with less than 3 minutes to go now.
Now he's got to either put the ball up in the air or he's going to run speed option, I would imagine. He's got to get someplace where he can get outside.
Be a nice time for a halfback pass here if I was coaching.
I think you're really right. Also, I see that Ron Seaman's on the sideline talking to Coach Evangelist, and maybe we'll see him again shortly.
Ed Lesson split. Still wide. Covington in the slot. The speed option hits to Mabry. Gross with a block. Mabry diving close to the first down.
Mabry. I thought that was
that. The clock is still running.
Here's the head space, the ball space, and picks it off.
Fourth down, short.
Again, there wasn't anybody to come in to challenge the quarterback. He came down the line of scrimmage, and evidently they're hooking the end in. And once you get outside the end, that puts a lot of pressure on the corner.
The clock has stopped as the officials place the ball. It could be a crucial placement here. With Elgin in a fourth down situation, once again.
Once again.
Seems that they have to use all three of them to get close and then go for it on that fourth down play. I don't know if I want to take any bets on this one. Preston hitting again, Terry?
I just hope they don't, sometimes a coach tries to outbox himself and outthink the other coach. You know, it's the same with what you really do best. You try to outsmart the other guy, sometimes you get yourself fouled. So.
Fourth and one for Elgin on the 23-yard line. Biggest play for Elgin in the game. Tony Grove, over anxious, runs into his quarterback. Ball is fumbled. Larkin takes over. Recovered in there by Tom
Rodgers. I don't know if that's just supposed to be a straight dive, or maybe Kevin was supposed to do that reverse out and come back and handle a little counter. But I would imagine the only yard to go would have been a straight handoff, wouldn't you think?
I would think so. Tony Gross really came out of the block that time. He got a real nice jump. And
looked like Ron is expecting to go maybe outside the guard, right in that area, and instead Tony went to the center.
Bob Seaman enters the game for one play, and Elgin can capitalize on it. It's first and 10. Handoff inside to Davidson. Elgin scrapping, trying to steal the ball.
Line is called.
Interior of the Elgin line, doing their best. We have a timeout called here.
Tracy on the tackle. Pick up of the first four.
1:23 left in the game. Elgin down 14-7. At this time, I'd like to thank a lot of people for their cooperation and their help in bringing you this broadcast. I'd like to thank School District U46 and Superintendent Dr. Richard Legall, the Larkin High School Principal Dr. John Penoyer, Coach and Athletic Director Ray Haley, the Elgin High School Football Coach Steve Evangelist, the Elgin High School Athletic Director Phil Chesbrough. Abbott fakes to Davidson, keeps it inside, picks up big yards, a crucial first down, clock running with 1:15 left.
Kirk did that on his own. There wasn't much room at the line of scrimmage, and like I say, sometimes those work, those counters, and sometimes they don't.
One minute left in the game. Larkin holding on to the slim one touchdown lead, but with a first down. Abbott running straight ahead. Hard straight making the tackle. With some tempers flaring out there. Personal foul call. Also like to thank our excellent crew today for their fine work. Mike Volkening, Scott Dale, Joe Solano, Cindy Leonardo, technicians. And the Volker, our producer and director. 15-yard penalty assessed against the Maroons.
Also would like to thank Stan Donegan, Dean of Students from Elgin High School, for his fine commentary today. And Terry Shaver, head sophomore coach at Larkin High School. Did a fine job, Terry.
Well, thank you very much.
Our staff people, Brad Nelson, spotter Ken Hudgens, for their assistance. Four seconds remaining. First down for Larkin High School, and they're just going to run it right out, and the Larkin line is just fired up, driving the Maroons back. I think this is all over.
Sometimes when you see that
timeout for Elgin, timeout Elgin, and 22 seconds left. So the timeout here, 22 seconds left, and the Larkin Royals now go four straight.
And actually, I don't think it's so much that Larkin defeated Elgin. I think Elgin defeated itself. It made some of the big mistakes, and they knew the ball really well on Larkin. And a couple breaks here and there, things that they did wrong, they probably would have been in the ball game. They probably won the ball game.
A block punt. The big play, like you said, the missed handoff, the fourth down. Those kind of things can happen. A lot of penalties. So Ray Hayden will be able to manage to continue to have a winning season at Larkin High School.
You always want to finish above 500.
And Steve Evangelist sees his chances to go over 500 in the Upstate 8 shadows here, as Elgin will finish 3-4 in the Upstate 8, playing a fine season as the crowd calms down the final seconds here. And it's all over with Larkin High School defeating Elgin 14-7 in the 20th meeting of these two teams. Larkin now is in the 4-3 record in the conference and continues to stay on top of Elgin in this series, holding the edge 12-8. That's the fourth consecutive win for Larkin that ties the record that Elgin set between 1975 and 78. It's an excellent game to see, and I think that the school district U46 and the city of Elgin should be proud as part of all these athletes. Dan, could you have any comments for us as we close?
I thought it was an excellent game. I thought it was a hard-fought game, and like Terry was saying, just a few breaks for Elgin, and could have been a completely different ball game. That long run back by John Covington called back, and a few crucial fumbles, and it's a different ball game altogether.
Like to say that I think all Elgin wins, no matter what side of the river wins, the kids are out there and they handle themselves really well, and I know as a coach, I'm proud of both squads the way they play today. And I'd like to say that Steve Evangelist has done a really, really great job at the start of the season, and his kids have played, come on really well, and maybe next year with that undefeated freshman team coming up and a good sophomore team, that played really well this year. He's got a bright future here in Elgin High School.
Well, I certainly agree with you, Terry. I think that both squads showed a lot of poise and a lot of character, and they played well all season, coming from behind in many games. So next year, I'm sure there'll be another exciting matchup between Elgin and Larkin. The scoring today, Dan?
In the first quarter, Scott Brummel blocked the John Covington punt, and Mike Austin picked up the ball and ran 37 yards for the first score of the ball game. Kirk Abbott converted the point after touchdown, and at 3:12 of the first quarter, the score was Larkin 7, Elgin 0. Larkin again scored after recovering an Elgin fumble on Elgin's 21-yard line, and that drive took four plays and was culminated with a 7-yard run by Kenny Harris, and again the kick for point after touchdown was good by Kirk Abbott. So with only 20 seconds remaining in the first quarter, the score was Larkin 14, Elgin nothing. The second quarter saw no scoring at all, and Larkin went in at halftime ahead 14-0. In the third quarter, the kickoff, John Covington returned the opening kickoff 98 yards, and the point after touchdown was converted by Tom Cothran, And at 11:42 of the third quarter, the score was 14-7 in favor of Larkin. And that was the end of the scoring for the ball game.
Thank you, Stan. Brad, could you give us the stats from the game?
Yes, Elgin's totals were John Covington had 5 carries for a total of 24 yards. Ron Seidman carried the ball 3 times for 7 yards. David Mabry, 8 carries for 20 yards. Preston Hinton, 16 carries for 58 yards. Tony Gross, 86 yards on 21 carries. Ron Seidman was 1 for 4 for 0 yards and 2 interceptions. And Elgin had 6 penalties for a total of 90 yards. Larkin's overall statistics, Ken Harris had 8 yards on 2 carries. Steve Barkley had 16 yards on 6 carries. Pat Davidson carried the ball 8 times for 34 yards. And Kirk Abbott had 17 yards on 9 carries. Kirk Abbott was 4 for 12 for 35 yards with 1 interception. Reception-wise, John Haas had 20 yards on 2 catches. Scott Miller had 12 yards on 1 catch, and Steve Barkley had 3 yards on 1 catch. The penalties for Larkin, they had 4 of them for 60 yards total.
Thank you, Brad. Stay tuned for post-game interviews with the coaches and some of the players as Channel 6's coverage of the Elgin-Larkin game continues.
My big brother Larry. Larry's my friend, and we do lots of things together.
Many boys these days are growing up without a father. They're not bad kids, they just need a friend. That's why I'm a big brother. My little brother Tony is a good boy, and I don't think he should have to go it alone. I feel that I can really make a difference in his life. Give him a chance, and all it takes for me is just a few hours a week.
Don't you want a little brother like me?
Call the Big Brothers of the Fox River Valley at 888-3111 and be a big brother.
Congratulations, Ray, on picking up a fine win against Elgin High School today.
Thank you, Ken. It's always nice to win the Elgin-Larkin game.
Well, what do you think about this game? It wasn't the best played by either team, but a win's a win nonetheless.
Well, if I was a painter, I wouldn't be too pleased with my art today, although we're very pleased to win and chalk it up in a win column for us. But it wasn't a very well-played ball game, I don't believe, on our part, and neither do I feel that they played particularly well. The momentum switched a couple of times. We in the first quarter we got ahead, and the first half we had 2 and thought that perhaps we should have had maybe more, and then they broke the opening kickoff the second half and gained momentum, and we just kind of let them take it to us the rest of the game. Our defensive team we thought played very well over the long haul. They've got extremely good speed in Covington and Gross, and we were worried about that all day. And one of our goals was to contain the speed and not let them have the easy touchdown. They did break the opening kickoff the second half, but other than that, we didn't give up the long run that's been killing most teams that they've been beating.
Now, you changed defenses quite a bit with a lot of different substitutions. Was that to throw off the offensive game plan?
Right. We do a lot of things defensively, and Larry Huizenga has done a super job and with the overall defense, and Ed Washington and Mike Korff have done an excellent job with the line. And we do a lot of things defensively against most teams, and we try not to be a static type of team. We show them different things, and we disguise a lot of things. So we feel like that's very helpful. And against a team with all that speed, if you just sat in a standard defense, I think they'd pick you apart pretty well.
What about offensively? It seemed that you really couldn't mount a good drive in the second half.
Well, we stuttered a lot during the game, which is typical when I think you're not blessed with a great deal of speed. We're not nearly as quick as we have been, and I think that you saw Elgin has some great speed. But when you don't have an awful lot of speed, it's difficult to sustain the type of drive that you have to do with speed that's not there. And so, consequently, we haven't scored but 2 touchdowns in any one game this year except last week against Lake Park. So our defense, I think we've had an excellent kicking game throughout the year. And Charlie Propernick's done a very, very nice job of punting throughout the year. And then Kurt Abbott's just been sensational kicking off and extra points and field goals. So our kicking game and our defense has probably sustained this pretty well during the year.
That had to be one of the longest point after touchdowns attempts that I've seen.
when Kirk Abbott kicked that one across.
Well, he's capable. I don't know if you saw our Addison Trail game. He kicked a 45-yard field goal. We got a penalty on the play. I believe it was a motion penalty or an infraction by Elgin, so I put it down to the 1.5. So we were going to go for the 2 points, and then we had it in the end zone, but we clipped on it, got 15 yards. But that's still in his range, so it worked out pretty well.
And that was into the wind. Once again, Coach Haley, congratulations. Congratulations on a fine year.
Wait, one thing, Ken. I've got my wife sitting over here, and I wouldn't ordinarily do this, but I think a coach was coached this game for 20 years. I'd like to get my wife here. My wife has seen every football game I've ever coached in 28 years. So I'm very proud of my coach. She's the best coach's wife a guy ever had. She sees our game films before the game, and I'm extremely proud of her.
Thank you.
What are your thoughts on today's game?
I'm glad that we came up on top on the winner.
Now, how is it being a coach's wife? It's not an easy task.
It never gets any easier, never at all. I love football, so I enjoy the game. But they're tough.
They're tougher on her than they are on me. You know, a lot of times in coaching, I'm on the field, and I don't necessarily hear fans. But my wife sat through that all these years. And she's my best fan, and I'm really proud of her.
Thank you.
Well, Steve, it was a tough loss and very aggressive, very physical game today.
Well, again, it was. We, offensively, we just didn't play as hard as I thought we should have. We didn't get off the ball. It seemed like they were establishing control at the line of scrimmage, and, we had some holding penalties at really critical times, and, we just haven't, done this in the last 3 or 4 weeks. We've always moved the ball well, win or lose. And I don't think you can't take anything away from Larkin. They did a good job of containing Tony and our backs. We do have a little speed, and they did a good job. You can't take anything away from them. But, at the same time, we didn't play with any, any fire. It was kind of a, 3 yard and a cloud of dust game. So, I guess sometimes you have those.
It seemed once again that the team, as you mentioned, waited until the second half before they really started to fire out and move the ball.
Yeah, we went in and we told them. We already gave them the 2 touchdowns, and they've already got their points. And, we're going to come out second half and, ram the ball down the field and score. And by George, we took the opening kickoff to score. And, it's kind of disheartening, that our offense didn't score. And because we scored well all year. And, again, a credit to Larkin and their defense. Defensively, I thought we played well. They only scored one offensive touchdown, and key penalties put our defense in the hole a lot early in the game, and they stayed with it and got the ball back for it. So, credit to our guys defensively.
And you had poor field position most of the game. I think there were one time, and there was three times that you had the ball inside the 10-yard line on each possession.
Well, that's true. We didn't have a good field position. But every time we thought we'd get something going, we had a holding penalty or, something really major. Those are things, kids aren't trying to do that. I don't know if it's a mental lapse. Well, we thought we were physically and mentally ready, ready for today's ball game. And, right back, the old cliche, the team with the fewest mistakes wins. Hate to use that because it's overused, I know. But we made more mistakes than we lost. And, there's no excuses or anything like that.
Now, what happened to Ron Seatman? How much of effect do you think that might have had on you?
Well, we thought we had enough time. We run the ball with our Kevin Baldwin, our replacement. He twisted his knee. I'm not sure right now how severe it is, but we were just afraid that, at that point we couldn't put the ball in there. We had to keep the ball on the ground, but, he came back in. He said he could run. I watched him run on the sideline, and he ran hard and ran without a limp, so we put him back in there. And I'll be darned if we're going to the first down and Tony Gross, slips and falls down, the
big play
running back. Oh, it was probably over 2 minutes to go in the game. We get a first down. I think we could have been there and scored.
Well, you made a lot of difficult decisions on fourth down and short yardage, and they were successful. But that must have been quite difficult for you to decide to go for it.
Well, actually, they were pretty easy once you make the first one. we thought if we're going to have a chance, the way things were going, the tempo of the game and everything, we were going to have to take a chance. And after we got that first down on the gamble, it was easy after that. It's like when a kid quits something and he can become a quitter easy. you know, the second, third time isn't hard to do. So, you know, we knew right from the start we were going to go for it. It's a matter of selecting, the type of play we wanted to run. But, you know, again, a credit to Larkin. And, you know, I thought we had, an up and down season. We won some key games, two of the top teams in the conference, the one that we beat. And it ended up crazy. I wish we could have won.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you, Ken.
This is Ken Bates for Channel 6 Sports, and this concludes our coverage of the 1982 Elgin-Larkin football game. Once again, that final score, Larkin 14, Elgin 7.